Ray Lynch, Michael Hedges, Constance Denby o Stephen Kindler son músicos que ya os hemos presentado con anterioridad en Música NA y que, como sabéis, han escogido la zona de San Francisco como lugar de residencia. Y es que San Francisco reúne las mejores condiciones tanto estéticas, no tenéis más que recordar la Bahía o el Golden Gate de Sausalito, como prácticas, puesto que allí se concentran un gran número de sellos discográficos y además escuelas y fábricas donde la alta tecnología se ha puesto al servicio de la música, como es el caso del Silicon Valley, el Valle del Silicio o la Escuela de Música de Stanford que os presentábamos hace apenas unas semanas. El mundo relacionado con la nueva música instrumental en la zona de San Francisco ha experimentado diversos cambios en los últimos años. Muchos músicos han abandonado la región para afincarse en lugares más tranquilos, pero la gran mayoría de los sellos discográficos siguen teniendo sus sedes en San Francisco o lugares cercanos. Windham Hill, una de las compañías pioneras en la difusión de nuevas músicas, ha crecido y está creando nuevos subsellos especializados en folk y jazz. Lo mismo ocurre con Global Pacific, muy interesado en la música étnica y folk, y Music West, que ha creado un sello de blues. Otras compañías más pequeñas como Hearts of Space, The World, Summertown y New Albion se están consolidando como algunos de los sellos más innovadores de los años 90. En Oakland vive uno de los mejores bajistas de Estados Unidos, Michael Murray, que graba para Windham Hill. Él mismo nos explica su peculiar técnica para tocar el bajo.
I've always been very fascinated by the idea that as beings we have two hands and two sets of everything, and indeed we even have two brains that work somewhat independently of each other. And as a musician, I've always been fascinated with how that applies to music and the fact that we can actually produce two different things simultaneously to do two different sounds. To pianists, this is a very familiar concept, but for bassists it's a bit unusual. And it's something I've been often experimenting with on the bass, with doing two completely different things at once for quite a while. But one of the problems with bass is that it's often hard to really distinguish two separate parts. And so I developed the idea of actually playing two basses simultaneously and two very different instruments. And this has really helped me a lot because these two instruments have a rather different sound. They're a different kind of instrument, and I've also tuned them differently, so they both have a different character. This one has that kind of a sound. This one's a little brighter, a little bit more zingy. And it's possible to play the bass with one hand in this way. Just by tapping down on the string. And I could do the same part on this bass. And it's the same music, but it has a different sound, has a different tone color. And what really interests me about this idea is that I can actually play two rhythms at the same time, such that it's possible to play three notes in the same time that you play two notes. So while this hand will be playing two notes, this hand will be playing three, so you'll get this kind of figure repeating over while this one's going. And if you set your brain just right, you can get this kind of sound. It's what's called polyrhythm, and it opens up a whole new kind of way of looking at the bass and playing. And it works really well with the two instruments because you can actually hear and distinguish the two different kinds of sounds. right now the keyboard is set up to emulate this instrument, and what you can do is there's an instrument that will actually record a small section of sound and make it so that you can play it over the keyboard. And something that I'll do from time to time is actually record my bass, and that, you know, to hear things in a different light. So what I did is I recorded that sound, and so then now I can play it over the whole keyboard. And I can do things there that I wouldn't necessarily do on the bass, because, you know, there are different sorts of ways that the keyboard's laid out that the bass isn't. And then I can record a performance into the computer, and the computer will trigger this, and I can play along with it so that, you know, you get this kind of sound. And you can play along with it and do a kind of duet with yourself, or to write a piece and, you know, experiment with it on the keyboards and get some different ideas. Thank you.
Uno de los hechos más llamativos en cuanto a las nuevas producciones musicales es que los sellos de música instrumental empiezan a editar discos que incluyen temas cantados. Tal es el caso de la pianista Barbara Higbee, o del dúo integrado por Sean Hurd y Scott. Sin embargo, el experimento parece que no funciona del todo y los discos con piezas vocales también incluyen temas instrumentales, que se siguen vendiendo mejor. La pianista Barbara Higbee, tras una larga carrera como miembro de Montreux, ha iniciado su carrera en solitario con temas instrumentales y otros cantados.
Thank you.
Uno de los músicos que experimenta con instrumentos electrónicos es el guitarrista Barry Cleveland. Su técnica consiste en ir creando en directo sus propios acompañamientos, con sonidos procedentes de su guitarra. Las diferentes partes se van grabando en un secuenciador que las memoriza y repite, y así va creando una capa sobre otra.
A lot of it is improvised, and we just take a basic idea and work with it for a while and hope that something comes of it. So it's not so much listening to a particular type of music and saying, I'd like to compose something or play something that sounds like that. It's more that if you listen to a lot of different things, then when you go to improvise, those influences just sort of come out on their own, and it's not really a conscious thing. I started getting interested in music when I was about 10 years old. I liked the Beatles and used to listen to the radio a lot. But when I was about that age and a little younger, I was more interested in astronomy and science. And when I got to be about 13 or 14 years old, I thought I would be much more popular socially as a rock and roll guitar player than as a scientist. So I started playing the guitar, sold my telescope and bought a guitar. And learned to play pretty quickly, and started playing professionally when I was about 17 years old, playing rock and roll in nightclubs and things like that. And then I got interested in progressive rock and jazz and more sophisticated kinds of music. And I've been using effects and unusual playing techniques pretty much since I started playing.